Okay, hello and welcome to GE103. This is the second lecture of structures. So before we start covering new material today, we are going to do a recap of the last lecture. So if you would recall, we had just started our discussion of structures and structure variables in the last lecture. So here's a recap of what we had essentially covered in that. So first thing we had looked at was that a structure is a user defined complex data type. So here we are talking about two different terms, user defined and complex. So this is to distinguish from or compare from system defined and simple data types. So when we look at data types like integers, characters, and floating points, they have been defined for us by the system. So we don't need to redefine them. And because they have already been system defined, we just need to declare variables of those data types. And then we can perform all the permitted operations on those variables. And also they are simple because they can contain only one kind of value. So here we're talking about more complex data types. For example, we looked at a point which can have two values, the x and y coordinate. We can also look at a student which can have a large number of values like name, grade point average, address, graduation date, and so on. So the data types here are complex because each structure variable can have many different kinds of members, which are variables in themselves. And the other thing is these structures are user defined, so we have the capability of defining appropriate structures based on our requirements. So it's quite a powerful tool available for us when we define and perform operations with data structures. So user defined complex data type, that's what a structure is. At its heart, it's a collection of one or more variables, possibly of different data types, which are grouped together under a single name for convenient handling. So for example, looking at the student case, CGPA would be a floating point, name would be a set of characters, graduation date would, well, of course, be a date, and so on. So you have different member variables, possibly of different data types, and they're all packed together, grouped together under a single name for convenient handling. Next, we know how to define structures now. So using the keyword struct, then providing a name, and then within curly braces, we define one by one all the member variables. And then we finally end the definition with a semicolon. So we know how to define structures, we know how to create the variables. So inside main, we can say something like struct point p1. And we can perform certain operations on those structure variables. So some of the operations we saw were accessing the structure members. So using the dot operator, for example, p dot x, p dot y, we can assign values. P dot x is 0, p dot y is 0 for the origin. We can pass structure variables as function arguments. So taking two points and returning the sum returned from a function. So we saw that structure variables can also be returned from a function. So essentially these all of these operations can be performed on simple variables, system defined variables, and they can also be performed on complex user defined variables or structure variables. So today what we are going to do is we are going to look at a new and a very important operation, and that operation is using pointers with structures. So just like we can use pointers with regular variables, we can have a pointer to an int, pointer to a character, and so on. In a similar manner, we can use pointers with structure variables. Okay, so here we are seeing a picture which depicts using a pointer with both a regular variable and a structure variable. So there are two parts to this. If you look at the part on the left hand side, again this we have already covered in the chapter on pointers, which was chapter number 5. So if you see what's going on the left side, we've got a regular variable and integer with a name of v, and the value inside v is 10. So we can get that by saying int v is equal to 10. Next, what we have is we've got a pointer pointing to that variable v. So we get that effect. We'll declare a pointer saying int star p, and then to make the pointer point to the variable, we'll say p is ampersand v. So we know that ampersand v gives us the starting memory address where v is stored. Okay, so it's integers of 4 bytes. So starting memory location we can get using ampersand v, and then what we do is we just assign that starting memory location to p. Right, so now p contains the starting memory location of v, or in other words, p points to v. Now that we have done that, important thing here is using the pointer p, we can manipulate the regular variable v that it points to. So if we say printf star p, we'll get a value of 10. So main concept over here is if a pointer is pointing to a variable of the same data type, then when we dereference that pointer, the effect is that we can access the value of the variable that it points to, and then we can of course make changes. So we can say star p is star p plus plus, right, which will set the value as 11 and so on. So essentially star p becomes an alias for v, which in this case is 10. Now focus your attention on the right hand side of the same slide, and here we have the same scenario. Only difference is instead of simple regular variable v, here we are dealing with, we are looking at a structure variable. So because it's a structure variable, here we've got two different member variables. So this is the same example point that we have been discussing all along in this chapter. So we have a struct point p1 comma star p. So we've got a structure variable, and then we've declared a pointer variable of the same data type. So data type of both p1 and star p is struct point, right? So that's fine. And now what we do is we need to make the pointer point to p1. So we just go like before, p is equal to ampersand p1. Okay, so now the effect of this is p points to p1, or in other words, p contains the starting memory location of p1. Right, so it's got, p1 has got two member variables, so most likely both, and because both are ints, so most likely 8 bytes have been reserved. So the first memory location, the memory location for the first byte, is now what p contains. So just like in the left hand case, star p is now an alias for p1. Right, so in the previous case star p was an alias for v, now star p is an alias for p1. The only difference is when we are accessing p1, then just writing down p1 is not enough. We have to use the dot operator. So structure variable name and dot member variable will get us, you know, those values that we need. So p1.x gets us the x coordinate for p1. p1.y of course gets us the y coordinate of p1. So if you want to access those member variables using the pointer, so then the effect is what we need to do for that is star p dot x star p dot y. So right, so if you recall, since star p is an alias for p1, so star p and p1 are similar, and therefore in place of p1 we can use star p. So that's all that we are doing, and note that we had to put the brackets around in both cases. And now why we needed to do that has to do with precedence. So we're going to look at that in the next slide. So here we're just showing that we can have pointers to regular predefined variables. In a similar manner, we can have pointers to structure variables as well. So we'll shortly look at sample program, a bunch of sample programs, but this is a small piece of code which is doing that. So struct point p1 star p, and then using the variable p1, we assign values to x and y components. p1.x is 1, p1.y is 1. Then we make the pointer point to p1, and then using the pointer we dereference and point the print the x and y components. So now let us just look at this program. So this is the whole program, our first program that shows how pointers can be used with structure variables. So the goal of this program is very simple. We have a simple regular variable. We have a point, and then we make a pointer point to that point. Both the pointer and that point have same data types, struct point. And then once that pointer is pointing, then using the pointer, we dereference that. And then after the dereference, we print out the x and y components of the structure variable. So if you see at the top, we are just defining our structure data type. So struct point, int x and y. We've been doing this in the previous examples also. So we first define the structure data type. Then inside main, we declare two variables, right? So one of them is a regular variable, point p1. Other is a pointer variable, star p. And hopefully that will point to p1. Now using the regular variable, not using the pointer, we assign the x and y components for p1. So we go p1.x is 1, p1.y is 1. And then we say p is ampersand p1. So now p points to p1, or p contains the starting memory location of p1. So probably there'll be a block of 8 bytes reserved. And we know we have one memory location for 1 byte, all contiguous. And the first of those location, or location of the first byte, will now be contained in P. Okay. And now what we're doing is, we can see we have two different printfs, and our intention and both of them is the same. Using the pointer, we want to print the X and Y components of P1. So this is similar to the dereferencing operation of before. So if we say int v is 10, and then int star p, then p is ampersand v, then printf star p is going to print 10. So using the pointer, dereferencing the pointer, we print the variable that it points to. So the effect here is, now star p is an alias for p1, same thing. And now if we want to print the x component of p1, we have to do p1.x. So likewise, using the pointer, we have to do the same thing, star p.x for the x component of p1 and star p.y for the y component of p1. Okay. And another shorthand for the same, getting the same effect is p arrow x, p arrow y. So this arrow notation, we are going to be encountering this a lot when we look at data structures like trees and linked lists. So what this arrow does is, if you have a pointer pointing to a structure variable, and if using the pointer you want to access or you want to manipulate those values of the variables that pointer points to, then you can use the arrow operator. So that means star p dot x is analogous to p arrow x, and star p dot y is analogous to p arrow y. So if you see in the previous program, when we were using the pointer to access and print the x and y components of P1, so there we used this particular notation, star p dot x. And if you had noticed, we have put brackets around star and p. So the question is, why did we put these brackets, and why could we not have just said star p dot x without the brackets? So as you can guess, the reason for this is operator precedence. So if you go back and look at the operator precedence chart, the operators we need to compare are the dereference and the dot operator. So looking at the chart, we see that the precedence of the dot operator is higher than that of the dereference one. So therefore, without the bracket, star p dot x is evaluates to star and then p dot x. So now question is this correct? Is this going to work? It is not going to work because the star is used for dereferencing. And when we look at p dot x is not a pointer. So therefore, this is incorrect. So therefore, if we put the bracket around star and p, then that is going to have the intended effect. So note that the dereferencing operator is designed to work with a pointer, and p dot x is not a pointer. It's a regular integer variable. Okay, so therefore, the brackets are necessary. So as we had mentioned in the previous, when we were discussing the code for this program, there is an alternate notation for star p dot x, and that alternate notation is p arrow x. So the rule is that if p is a pointer to a structure variable, then p arrow member of structure refers to the particular member. In our case of points, it can refer to either x or y. Right, so star p dot x is syntactically equivalent to p arrow x, and star p dot y is syntactically equivalent to p arrow y. So this arrow notation, we are going to be seeing this a lot when we discuss more data structures in detail. So here we have one more example of a pointer to a structure. This one is a bit more elaborate than the previous one. So consider this following code. So we have, we're defining a structure, struct X, and there are exactly two member variables of this. One member variable is length, its data type is an integer, and the other member variable is pointer, str, and its return, its data type is character. And finally, what we're doing is we're declaring a pointer to this structure, to a variable of this structure. So note the declaration of the pointer within the structure definition itself. This is very much possible. Okay, so what we have is we've got a structure named X with two members, an int and a character pointer. And we also have a pointer which will hopefully point to a structure variable of data type X. So now question is, what does plus plus p arrow length point evaluate to, right? So here again, the issue is that of precedence. So when we have plus plus and when we have arrow, which is more important, again, if we look at the operator precedence chart from chapter 2, we see that the arrow operator has a higher precedence than plus plus. So arrow is on level 1 and plus plus is on level 2. So because of this, the effect of this statement is plus plus and then within brackets p arrow length. So the net effect is we get the length and then we increment it by 1. So we're using the pointer, we're getting access to length, the length component, and then we are incrementing it by 1. So from the previous slide, the effect will be to increment length by 1 and not p. So the expression we have is plus plus and then within brackets p arrow length. So the net effect is that it increases the value of length by 1 and it does not increment p. Of course, having said that, we can always use brackets to force a different sequence or a different order of execution. So what do we mean by that? So consider this expression now. plus plus p within brackets and then arrow length. So here what we are trying to do is we want to increment p first by 1, and then we want to print the associated length. So first of all, is this useful? We have to see that p is a pointer to x, and therefore when we do plus plus p, the effect is that it will increase the value of the pointer by 1, right? And in this case, as you can guess, the result will be undefined. So here we don't have any kind of array wherein if incrementing the pointer by 1 would make it point to the next element. So in this case, plus plus p would be the result we get, the effect of that would be undefined. Okay. So the value of that plus plus p would be undefined. Okay. So as another example, we consider star p arrow str. Okay. So once again, if you look at the definition of x, it's got int length as one member variable and the other is char star str. So now when we say star p str, what does that evaluate to? So again, the answer lies in the precedence, and we see that upon checking the precedence table, the arrow has a higher precedence or importance as compared to the dereference. So the net effect of this expression is it evaluates to star or dereference and then within brackets p arrow str. So first p arrow str is evaluated, and as we can see, what this will do is give us the value of str. So hopefully the string points to some character or the other, because the return type for that is char star. So hopefully str points to some character, and p arrow str will give us, you know, the value of str, right? And then when we dereference it, we will actually get the value of that character, right? So the result which we can hope to get from this expression is this would fetch whatever str is pointing to, which would be a character. So note that if p is a pointer to a structure variable, then using p arrow member variable, we can get the value of the various member variables of the structure variable that p points to. So p str gives us the value of str. So provided it's pointing to some character or a character, current character in an array, so dereferencing it will give us the value of that character. Okay, so now we are ready to look at our second program. So this is based on the structure X that we have just talked about. Okay, so let's see what's going on in this program. So as we have mentioned before, the source code of all programs is available on the Moodle webpage of the course. So all of you should download the code, you should all study it, you should all execute it, and then try different scenarios. So here what we have is, first of all, we've defined the structure X. So as mentioned, it's got two member variables, length, which is an integer, len, and then str, which is a pointer to a character. So at any point of time, it will point to one character or the other. Okay. So the intention is we'll make it point to one character or the other in a character array or in a string. So once we've defined those member variables, now within the definition itself, we are going to declare two structure variables. One is a regular variable p and the other is a pointer variable pp. So we know that it's possible to declare different kinds of structure variables within the definition itself. The other option is we don't declare in the definition, and inside main we say struct x star pp comma p. So both of the options would work. So inside main, expectedly what we do is we make the pointer point to the variable p. So pp is ampersand p, right? And now using the arrow operator, we can set the values for both length and str So what we do is pp arrow len is equal to 10 and pp arrow str is equal to hello. So we know that from previous chapter 5, we've seen that when we have code like this, char star s is equal to hello. So the effect of that is it takes the pointer s and makes it point to the first character of the string, which is h. Okay. And then subsequently, by using pointer arithmetic, we can, you know, walk through or jump through the array and then, you know, perform certain operations on it. So what we have is pp arrow str is equal to hello. So now the string str, which is a character pointer, points to h. And now, just as we have done using the pointer, we manipulate the components. So we say, instead of saying p dot len, we say pp arrow len is equal to pp arrow len plus 12. So now the value of length for a structure variable p would be what? It should now be 22. So when we say printf %d double p arrow length, we should get a value of 22. So you can check that. Next thing what we're doing is we're saying printf %c new line and then star double p arrow str. So here again we've got the dereference and we've got the arrow. So the arrow has a higher precedence, so the effect is star and then within brackets double p str. So double p str is a pointer to h, which means it contains the memory location of h. So then when we dereference it, we can now print h. Okay, so the value of that will be h and then new line. And now let's see what we're doing. We're using some sort of loop now. So we've got int I is equal to 0 and then for initialization is done, so we have nothing there. Then I is less than 5 and then plus plus I. So how many times is this loop going to run? It is going to run for I is equal to 0, 1, 2, 3 and 4. It's going to run 5 times. So let's see what we are, what's going on. Is it printing in each iteration? So first I is equal to 0 and it prints %c star pp arrow str. So again, it's going to print what it printed in the previous printf, which is h. Right? And then what we do is pp arrow str plus plus. Right? So again, what is exactly is going to happen here? So again, looking at the precedence chart, the arrow is higher in importance than the plus plus. So the effect is it is going to do double p arrow str first, right? And that actually gets us the value of str, the value of the pointer. And then when we add 1 to it, so we know that the pointer is pointing to a string on an array of characters. So when we increase that pointer by 1, now it will point to the next character. So now you would get a gist, an idea of what is happening. Next time the for loop runs, it prints E and then it prints L, then it prints L a second time, and then finally it prints O and we get out of the for loop. So the final output would be 22 and then in a new line H and then all in new lines H, E, L, L, O. Right, so again you can download the code and run it. So the goal of this program is using the pointer, we manipulate the variable that it points to. So we're doing the same operation what we did with regular variables like characters and ints. Okay, so which includes different kinds of pointer arithmetic. Okay, so now let's look at our next program. So here again, the goal is to see how we can use structure and structure variables. Okay, so let's see what's going on in this program. So here again, as before, we've got a structure data type called IS, that's the name, and it has got two member variables. One of them is a character array named A, capable of storing 10 elements, 10 characters. Second member variable that it has is an index, which of course is an integer. So an array, memory location for reserved for storing 10 characters, and an index to that array. So indexes will run from 0 to 9. Okay, so that is the structure definition for IS. Next, what we see is a function, right? So the name of the function is f, as you can see. The return type is char, so this means that this function is supposed to return a character. So the arguments are a bit interesting. So the second argument is an integer, but the first argument is a struct is star. So what this tells us is the first argument is a pointer to a structure. So we've seen earlier that when we were covering chapter 5 on pointers, that it may very well be the case that a function may accept a pointer as one of the arguments. So in a similar way, here we have a function which has a pointer to a structure as one of the arguments. So what will probably happen is, inside the main we'll declare a structure variable, then we'll declare a pointer to structure, and then we'll make the pointer point to that structure variable, and then that pointer will be passed as an argument to f. Okay. So the code of f is given at the bottom, right? So first let's look at the main, what's going on here. So as expected, struct isi, right? So what we are saying here is we are declaring a structure variable named I, that's the identifier, and which means that its data type is struct is, right? So it's supposed to have two values for a and index. And now what we're doing is we are calling string copy. So if you recall from chapter 5, what string copy did was copying one string to the other using pointers, right? So if you have one particular string, one array of characters, for example, and you've got a pointer pointing to the first character in that string, then you can copy that string to another string, and you have a second pointer at the receiving end. So one by one, you copy whatever the pointers are pointing to, and then you increment both pointers by one. So implementing it was not hard. So here what we have is a line of code. We have is a string copy I dot a, and then a b c d e f g h, right? So again, what is I dot a, right? So a, as we know, a is an array. So when we use the array, just the name without any brackets, so then we know that it's an alias for the memory location of the first element of that array. So a and ampersand a of 0 are syntactically equivalent. So what we have here is I dot a. So definitely we can say that I dot a is a pointer, right? It has a memory location of first element of a, right? It's a pointer. And then on the for the second argument, we can provide the whole string. So the effect of this is going to be that it is going to copy whatever's on the right, the string, to A. Okay. So of course we have enough size, because if we count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, we've got 10. Of course, it may we may also have the null to worry about. So here we have So it's copied. So it copies ABC up till J to array A. That is what it's going to do. And next, what we're doing is we are saying I dot index is equal to 4. Okay. So we set that. Right. So structure variable name and dot member variable and 4. Now what we do is we do printf and then percentage s I dot a. Right. So percentage s expects a pointer which we are going to be providing, and then it takes over, and then one by one it prints all the characters of the string. So what we're going to get as a result of printf percentage s I dot a is it is going to print the whole string. So a, b, c, d, e, f all the way up to j. Now next, when we printf I dot index, of course it's going to print 4. Right. So that, hopefully that is clear. Now what we're going to do is we are going to be calling function f. Okay, so let's see. So what we have is calling f, and if you see the definition of f, what expects a pointer to structure is. Okay, so and what we're passing is a ampersand i. So we have a structure variable, and the starting memory address of that, so how much is going to be reserved for each structure variable, probably enough to store 10 characters, 10 bytes, right? And then enough to store one integer index, which is 4 bytes, so probably 10 plus 4, 14 bytes, hopefully. So now the effect is when we make this call f percentage i, so the effect is struct is star I is equal to ampersand i, right? So we can use the same identifier I for both cases because they are both local to their functions. I is local to main, star I is local to f. So now star I it points to that other I, right? And the other thing which is assigned is int in is equal to I dot index. So I dot index is 4, so n also becomes 4. And now what it does is return I arrow a n, right? So what exactly is going to be returned? What is the value of a n? N is 4, so a n will be equal to a of 4, right? So a of 4 would be the character with a of 4 would be, so 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, it would be e, right? So note that I is a pointer to the structure variable also named I. So therefore I arrow I a I n would give us a value of a of 4, so which is equal to e, and which is what it is going to return, and which is what the output of the third printf is going to be. And next what it does is I arrow index plus plus, right? So here again the value of index will be increased by 1. So the arrow is more important than in the level of precedence, it's higher than the plus plus. So first it does I arrow index, right? So the value of index, accessing it using the pointer, and then adds 1 to that, so the value will be 5. So in this case we're not really using it, right? So the output for this program is going to be, for the first printf, it's going to be A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, J. Second printf, it's going to be 4. And for the third printf, it is going to be E. Okay. So the new thing that we have seen in this program, which we have not seen before, is that pointers to structure variables can also be accepted as arguments to functions. In fact, not only that, a function can very well return a pointer to a structure variable. So then whichever function calls it, it may then use that pointer appropriately. Perhaps it may have a pointer of its own, and then both pointers get equated, and then using the arrow, it can probably print out the member variables, or it can perform, you know, certain operations on them. Okay. So I hope this program is clear. Again, the code is available on Moodle, so please do look at it, go through it. Okay, so this is the last slide. So let's wrap up today's lecture. So what did we learn about today? In today's lecture, we saw that how we can use pointer variables with structure variables. So in the previous chapter, we had seen how pointers are very effective, especially when we work with arrays. How using the pointer, we can manipulate the variables that they point to. So similar kind of provision is available for structure variables as well. So the ampersand and the star operators work as before. So we can use a star to declare a pointer variable of data type struct, and we can make it point to a structure variable using ampersand. And then again, we can use the same star operator to dereference that structure pointer. So we can use it to access, when we dereference, we can use it to access member variables of the structure variable that it points to. And so we also saw another notation, a new operator called the arrow operator. So if we have a pointer to structure variable, then using pointer name arrow member variable, we can access all the values of member variables of the structure variable that the pointer points to. Right. So finally, we went through a number of programs that used pointers with structure variables. So please go through all these slides, go through all the programs, and do let me know in case you have any kind of questions. Okay, so that's all for today's lecture. We'll continue in the next class.